Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the G League. We've got another first-round match coming up. It is going to be Lie Gaming versus IG, one of the few matches that I actually think, of course, I said this yesterday, but it didn't actually turn out to be true. It was a 2-0 sweep, but I actually think this next game is going to be pretty damn even. Like, when it comes to round one matches, you're always expecting a team to probably take it pretty easily 2-0 or maybe even 2-1, but I think this is one of the few matches that will actually be pretty damn close. As Lie Gaming have shown a lot of potential lately, and they have taken down some of the tier one teams. They beat CDEC once in a best of one. They've taken a game off of IG before in the past. In fact, not too long ago when they faced up against each other in a best of three, it wasn't that lopsided. So Lie Gaming, they're getting better, it seems like, every week. And this could be a big opportunity for them to prove that they have been making some leaps and bounds when it comes to improvement and are able to take on some of those tier one teams. So Lie Gaming, they start themselves out with the first pick, Skywrath Mage, followed up by a second pick, a Batrider. Invictus Gaming, though, in their draft, with the Skywrath Mage already being laid down, they immediately go for two of the tankiest initiators in the game, the Brewmaster as well as the Tidehunter. Now, this is an interaction where the Skywrath Mage, while he can be seen as a bit of a counter to the Brewmaster due to the fact the Brewmaster is a blinking initiator that relies heavily on his abilities and does not go for BKB, so a long duration silence is actually a very good way to counter the Brewmaster, but at the same time, Skywrath Mage is exceptionally squishy. He starts out with no armor, so that first hit critical from the Brewmaster is going to do a lot of work to that Skywrath Mage. And then add in the fact that the natural tankiness of the Brewmaster may allow him to soak up some of that Mystic Flare damage without actually dying and possibly still getting off his ultimate once the silence fades. So while Skywrath Mage is a good counter to the blink ultimate of the Brewmaster, the blink clap and, in general, his natural tankiness do allow him to also be a decent Invictus counter to the Skywrath Mage in some way. It kind of goes back and forth. It all just depends how the game is played out. Now, Viper is going to be the third pick from IG, while the Rubick goes the way of Lie Gaming. So nothing too special on the side of Lie. Invictus Gaming following up with their, so far, good amount of synergy. Just a natural, like, okay, we're going to get double tanks, double initiators. This is a lot of team fight. The Viper fits perfectly into this kind of strategy where he is another big tanky hero that is able to soak up a lot of damage. And you're looking primarily at all magic damage for the side of Lie Gaming. So it makes sense that the Viper is made even more tankier when you're facing up against only magic damage like this. Now, with the Ogre Magi being picked up, Invictus Gaming get themselves a fourth tank. So we should have June playing the Tidehunter in the offlane. We've got a mid Brewmaster for Ferrari, and that'll leave us with a safe lane farming Luo. So, yeah, I'm liking the way the lanes are shaping up so far. They should have a really good shot. Nice pickup, though, by Lie Gaming. They grab this. Now, this is not actually for XTT. XTT is the offlaner for Lie Gaming. I believe the Batrider is still going to be the offlaner here, and they're actually going to be running Timbersaw. Zhaoji will be taking that one. And that is because, one, this is something they've done before. And two, this is when you're facing up against the Brewmaster, he's one of the very few mids that you can run a Timbersaw against. Timbersaw doesn't usually like to be going middle because, well, for obvious reasons, there's no trees there. And despite the lore being a little bit contrarian to his play, Timbersaw does like being around trees. He needs to be around trees. That's how he gets his pure damage from Whirling Death. That's how he has his escape mechanism with Timberchain. If you actually leave Timberchain at only level 1, it can be a little difficult to get back to your trees and just because the distance is so short. And oftentimes, you're not really maxing out Timberchain if you go middle as a Timbersaw. If you want to put more pressure on the Brewmaster, you're probably going to be maxing out your Whirling Death. So, and I think Timbersaw also It's purely because of the matchup, but I think that the Timbersaw mid got a slight little buff up when we have this double rune. It's why you're seeing a lot of other mids, such as the Zeus coming into play. I think some of that really plays into the double rune and being able to have that almost guaranteed bottle fill up. I think that really plays into the advantage of certain of these spamming heroes, and Timbersaw and Zeus being two of the most spam-worthy. The Shadow Shaman now going to be banned away by Lie Gaming, while the Animage banned out by Invictus. You could see why they would be afraid of the Animage. He's one of those carries that is, looking at the draft from IG, Animage is just hard enough of a carry that they have better late game at that point, but is also one of the fastest farming carries in the game at the same time, right? So Animage, there's this oftentimes, in order to balance out carries, the way you can look at them is basically look at how much time it takes for them to farm in order to be effective in team fights, in order to start really carrying the game, and how hard of a carry they are. Now, Animage, despite what many people think, is not one of the hardest carries in the game. He really isn't. He is actually more of a 45-minute to 55-minute carry. If you get past an hour, oftentimes you're going to be out-carried by someone else, and that's solely because of the fact that Animage, while he does have decent stats, his magic armor is amazing and all that sort of thing, there are other carries who scale much better than an Animage. And it's really shown in the fact that Animage will get six slotted so early on into the game, and we'll try and carry from there, but eventually you're going to have certain carries like Phantom Assassin, Spectre, those kind of, even Weaver, I think, is a better carry than Animage, in that the that you're able to scale much better than an Animage, but these heroes don't farm as quickly as an Animage. So the way I'm looking at this game is that the Animage would have been kind of perfect in that he would out-carry any of the members of IG if this went late game, but he would also come online fast enough to be able to deal with what is going to be a very obvious mid-game-oriented strategy. Now with their last pick of the Abaddon for Chizpug, this means that we're going to have double tanky supports, which is very odd to see, having two different melee supports. But it's going to work because they actually have different roles. Most melee supports are initiators, and they fulfill kind of the same role. So you rarely see two of them, two melee supports in the same lane. But Abaddon is one of the few melee supports who actually doesn't fulfill the same role. He's not an initiator. He's a counter-initiator. So he's actually sitting back, despite the fact that he's a melee. He's oftentimes sitting back in the fight behind most of the other heroes, just waiting to get off those clutch aphotic shields. And this is going to make the Viper damn near unkillable between the two tanky supports that you're going to have in lane, combined with one of the tankiest ranged heroes early on, the Viper. This is going to be a very, very rough lane that they're going to be dealing with. But Lie Gaming, thankfully, are running a, well, actually, XTT. He's still going to be on the Timbersaw, but they're actually running him in the safe lane here up against the aggro Tri. I would have expected them to run the Weaver in this Tri lane, as that is more natural, but also the fact that Weaver would be able to deal, I think, very well with this aggressive tri lane, seeing as the only lockdown stun that they have would be the Fire Blast from Chuan, and the rest of it is going to be all slows. So even if they did lay down counter wards, I would have thought that this would have actually been a favorable matchup for the Weaver. Not favorable in that you're going to win the lane, but just that you're going to be able to deal with the aggro tri and probably shouldn't die. But instead, they're going to be running him in the mid lane. And that will leave us with the Batrider. Still, XDT will be playing that one, going up against June in the bottom lane. So, not quite what we expected, but still. And we also have different players playing different roles as well, because I assumed that Joji was going to be playing the Timbersaw, but instead it's going to be their one position player, XDT.
So
So early count award, going to be able to take out some of the visions so far. But other than that, Lie Gaming are just kind of forced to play this defensively, try and get whatever last hits they can. Timbersaw is still going to be effective against this lane because, again, they only have one stun. So it means the Timber Chain is a pretty reliable getaway. But at the same time, he does have to be careful when he uses it. He has to try and use it after the Fire Blast. Otherwise, you'll see many professional players, one of the biggest downsides of the Timber Saw is that the Timber Chain is very easy to interrupt. But so far, CS-wise, it seems to be going pretty decently for XDD. Meanwhile, the Brewmaster is actually going to be coming around here for the bottom regen rune. And filling up his bottle. It should be a CS war, pretty much back and forth. The only death that I'm really expecting is some sort of overextension here in the top lane from either side, or this bottom lane, where June may end up getting picked off by the Batrider just because of the fact that the sticking Napalm. It's so easy to bring a hero from full to nothing with a Batrider, especially a Batrider versus a melee hero. Even if it is a Tidehunter who's got that Kraken Shell advantage, which is really nice to have up against the sticking Napalm stacks, it's still a very dangerous lane for him. IG, they don't necessarily have to win their laning phase here. They do have a lineup that is more mid-game dedicated than anything else. And sure enough, here's your overextension. This is Rubick is done for. Ends up getting caught. Now, we are going to be having some lag, as you can see. First Blood just now coming up. This is just the perfect world server, guys. I can't really do much to fix it. I can try and reconnect. In fact, we'll do a reconnect right now while they have a pause. But it's unlikely to be able to fix itself. Sometimes it's just the way the cookie crumbles. So I had it yesterday. Probably going to be having it today. Maybe the reconnect will fix it. I have to say, though, I think the Weaver was a pretty solid pick. The Animage even would have left you kind of exposed. There we go. Yeah, looks like it's still quite laggy. So, I don't think we're gonna be able to fix it, guys. Cause I've done like 5 billion reconnects before, and sometimes it just will not want to cooperate. Sometimes the servers are just not right for us. So the Weaver topping out the board so far in this middle lane, sitting at 21-3. The Viper in second place, thanks to a large amount of denies, 22-8. Very nicely played by Lulu so far. Close, but not quite. The Tidehunter seems to be doing quite well up against the Batrider, getting quite a CS lead there, though XTT has gotten himself a decent number of denies, surprisingly enough. Batrider not really known for getting denies oftentimes. So, decent number there. They're actually going to be going for the dive here. Luo is going to be thrown up. Telekinesis, nice use of the Aphotic Shield to interrupt that one. But XDD will be able to get himself out nonetheless. Now the potential dive. XDD almost getting caught out, almost losing his potion there. But thanks to the nighttime, Chuan will lose vision. And the attempted dive does not work out for IG. Nicely defensively played by Lie Gaming, excluding the Rubick pickoff, which is bound to happen, I think, eventually. Just natural human error is going to happen. I think they played this lane pretty damn well. You can see what XTT is doing now that the Tidehunter has really gotten a lot more powerful. As soon as he hits level 5, that Anchor Smash is doing a lot of work and something that Batrider wants to try and avoid the harassment of. But the Ravage is really what gives the Tidehunter all his kill potential at this point. So it's XTT actually has to stay clear of that one now that he's got that big disable. Another rotation in. They're going to go for XDD here. Luo. Well, nice little block out, 5,400 is going to look telekinesis. And once again, the Aphotic Shield comes into play. Luo will just chase down the Rubick, but they'll get a return kill in Chizbug. And now going in for more. Luo in some serious trouble as the teleport from Weaver will give them the Nuffet advantage to be able to claim a 2-for-1 there in the favor of Lie Gaming. As, damn. Dire's middle tower. This, whew. His server is bad. Anyway, really great fight there for Lie Gaming, thanks to the Weaver. Really good job holding on to an early teleport scroll. Knowing that IG was going to be really aggressive in that aggro try, looking to make the dive, they've already telegraphed that once before, so it makes sense that they would try it again, and punishing them quite heavily for that, as the Viper going down was a huge pickoff. Batrider, meanwhile, just seems to be, well, it looks like he's going to be forced back, but he did get a double damage rune earlier. XDD may actually go down here just due to the damage over time. Tough to deal with, and sure enough, without any extra supports, he will fall. Kind of needed to throw a Timber Chain up in this region if he wanted to be able to get enough distance to get away from those slows, as cutting it just to the right wasn't good enough. Especially with a level 3 Timber Chain. Like, it has a pretty good range from where he was sitting. He would have been able to hit any number of these trees right here. But perhaps a little panic ends up skewing his decision-making a little bit. Looks like the Weaver is now going to be up here in this top lane now that he's got level 7, has the maxed out Chikuchi, plus the time-lapse. Will be able to deal with this aggression a lot better than the Timbersaw can, and perhaps they can rotate that Timbersaw into the middle lane up against a Brewmaster, which, again, is not a bad matchup for the Timbersaw in any way, just because it's a melee strength here. And that is always nice for a Timbersaw to face. Nice count award, 5,400, able to take down the early Rune Vision, and they'll also claim themselves a regen. And really surprised, it looks like Weaver's going to go back into this middle lane. They're going to put the Timbersaw bottom lane, where he's now been able to pick up his Arcane Boots. This is another matchup that is, of course, quite favorable for the Timbersaw, as another strength melee here, and that's why the Timbersaw was such a great pickup in the draft. Unfortunately, Tidehunter is still able to deal with this early on. If you put this matchup from the beginning, Tidehunter would lose it. But now... Whirling Death. But now, the Anchor Smash. Seeing as Timbersaw starts out with... he's only sitting on one armor right now when he doesn't have any reactive armor ticks. He's going to be taking practically the full amount of damage of every Anchor Smash. So he's actually tanking as much damage as he is dealing out to the Tidehunter. Stun on XDD, even if you can't see it, there was a stun. He will still be able to get himself out. It seems like Ravage not willing to be committed there for that kill. Bit surprised there. I mean, it's 9 minutes in. We are now level 8 on our Tidehunter without a single Ravage being used. If you're not going to be making this rotation, if you want to sit in lane and wait until you have a Blink Dagger, that's fine. Feel free to use a Ravage there, though. The attempt at a kill is well worth it, since you're going to be in this lane for another 2.5 minutes anyway, waiting for that Blink Dagger. You might as well go for kills, seeing as the Ravage being off cooldown is not really going to hurt you, since you're not planning on moving around anyway. Speaking of Blink Daggers, XTT has his and is looking to make a rotation in this top lane. He's been doing the jungle for a while and is hoping to see somebody show up in this top lane, though the reality is IG are actually going to be moving into middle, where Joji will be threatened a bit. Oh, he had the regen rune. Never mind. Forgot about that. And we'll also find an invis rune. What a lovely rune for a Weaver to have. Nobody will expect the invisible Weaver. I like that the fact that they're breaking this aggro try of theirs. Their supports are beginning to be a little bit under farmed, though in comparison to Lie Gaming supports, it's actually not that bad. XDT in some trouble here, no longer having the Firefly, is going to be caught out, and 5400 could do nothing to save him here, as the Telekinesis is actually going to put him in danger. Sure enough, the Cyclone throws the Rubik up in the air, and he's in the middle of no man's land, surrounded by haters on all sides. IG find another pickoff, 5-2, and might be able to claim this tower, though it's going to be a trade-off if it is. June is going to teleport up to this top lane, try and protect his tower, and with the mass teleports following it up, it looks like they will be able to keep this tier 1 alive. At the same time, this middle tower shouldn't be going down, as Joji will put a stop to this aggression. Speaking of him, the Weaver, I'm wondering what his build is going to be for this game. I'm not quite sure Lincoln's is necessary, though it would help out quite a bit being able to deal with the Ogre Magi. Is the Fire Blast from him is probably one of the most effective ways, especially later on, that the Lincoln's can block some of those single target spells. You also have the Viper and that spam later on, because I'm sure the Viper is going to be going for an Aghanim's. While the Viper ultimate isn't necessarily good lockdown up against a Weaver for obvious reasons, slows don't really affect a Weaver that much, it is really good harassment later on when you do have the Aghanim's and you're able to spam it out every 12 seconds. So Lincoln's wouldn't be a bad choice here. I'm just wondering if maybe he needs to go for something that gives him a lot more sustain in teamfights, like a BKB. BKB, I would say, is a build that is more dedicated to actively fighting in the mid game, which I think is going to be a necessity for Lie Gaming, seeing as IG have had a pretty decent start in the laning phase so far and are really looking to press that advantage going into the mid game. IG making a rotation, are going to jump onto 5400 here. There is going to be some response from Lie Gaming, but not enough of one to deal with the five members of IG, especially with that early mech as well. Lie Gaming are just going to force to buy for time here, as they have to give up this middle tower. They can't possibly go in for five-man team fights just yet. That's why XDD is pushing in this top lane so hard, and the same applies to our Weaver for this bottom lane. And IG, afraid of giving up any extra towers to Lie Gaming, will actually make some rotations to put a stop to the split pushing. This will delay their mid push by quite a bit. Fortunately, they don't really have to worry about the Timber Saw chopping down this tower. Due to the buff of the Tier 2 tower's armor, they got an extra 5 armor with the last patch. But also, well, 5400 going to go down again here as the Rubick is. I feel like I'm just on repeat at this point. He's getting trashed quite thoroughly. He has 5 out of 7. Of the deaths on IG. Goes to show what how much he's being targeted. Though a lot of it is just bad positioning by him. Him being dove in the middle tier 1, I can't really blame him too much. Him being out of position here in this top lane, once, you know, it's going to happen again. It's bound to happen eventually. But this is beginning to be a bit too much now. He knows that IG are five-manning. He knows they're able to dive lanes, dive towers, and there's not going to be enough of a response from his allies to put a stop to it. They can't afford to TP in and try and punish IG for diving tier 1 towers, because they've got some great teamfight ultimates. Just imagine, like, all the advantage of fighting underneath your tier 1 tower is completely destroyed against, like, Brewmaster ultimate, which means you can tank up a lot and even have some extra units to be able to tank up for you. The Tidehunter ultimate, which is just such an overwhelmingly strong ability in some of these early team fights, he can't possibly deal with it. So Rubick needing to be a bit more cautious, though this play from him right here, if he got caught out right here, it'd actually be somewhat worth it, just because 5400 is basically scouting out the rotations in from IG in order to save his Timber Saw. And that's part of the reason he's being caught out, though he's not going to see that one. As Tuan was sitting in the side here, though, they blow the Ravage, and it's still not enough damage there. XDD looking to try and get enough distance, but a secondary stun coming in will put a stop to that one. The teleport away by the Skywrath Mage is successful, though. And IG make a three-man rotation. They found the Timber Saw, though. They found one of the cores, and that is good enough. So a small gold swing, nothing too major. 650 gold and experience going the way of IG. Speaking of which, let's take a look at that net worth. And I couldn't imagine it being too big of a lead for IG, but of course they are going to be ahead. 2,000 net worth and about, 750 experience. Very minimal experience lead, though. That's probably because while they do have so many more kills, they are also forced to group up a lot more, and that will limit the amount of experience you get from the laning phase. And a lot of this split pushing from Lie Gaming is giving them much more experience from killing creeps than it is for IG. Now, June is going to be spotted out here by this ward. Looks like Lie Gaming want to try and go for a pickoff on him, but now that he's back up to full health and is also on the retreat, unlikely to be able to find that one, unfortunately. though maybe they will. June is going to come back here, and they're going to look for the jump. June is going to be grabbed by the lasso. XDD, they're going to throw everything they have to try and blow him up, and they will be successful in their endeavors. The big, big pickoff there, taking down one of those solo. That's a lot of experience. A lot of experience going the way of Lie Gaming for that one, and something that Timbersaw drastically needs, as he's going to need his maxed out nukes. He's got the two levels of reactive armor. It gives him enough tankiness. I would say 13 and 14 aren't as important levels for Timbersaw, but getting up to level 12 is so key, so you can maxed out, have your maxed out Whirling Death plus have level 2 Chakram. I really feel like that's a certain kind of peak of power for Timbersaw that you don't really get until you hit level 16. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Pushing in the tier 2. Not much they can really do about this tier 1 tower going going down in the top lane. And yes, guys, I know, it is laggy. There's nothing we can do to stop it. It is not the stream. It is the Perfect World servers. What you are seeing on stream, seeing. I know. If you didn't hear it before, I will say it a couple more times throughout the cast. Seeing these people. Whoa, the Ravage being blown for that one. Alrighty then. That is commitment right there. Super will go down. A Ravage for a support? Well, they're not really finding too many pickoffs anymore, as Lie Gaming are really doing a great job moving around the map and split pushing them quite heavily. So I don't mind them that as much. Now, Joji is going to be caught out. Multicast goes down. But again, with the severe lack of stuns, it's hard to be able to keep that Weaver locked down. The Abaddon obviously has nothing. The Viper only has slows to be able to throw in. Looks like they really want to take this fight, though, up against a Viper with Mech and Abaddon backing him up. I can't imagine this fight being a very good trade for them. Force staff for the Batrider. Was it going to be jumped now by Ferrari? We do have some reinforcements coming in, but the force staff plus the telekinesis will be enough for the Batrider to get some distance. And now Lie Gaming continuing to see this aggression here in the top lane, knowing that there's probably a ward here, or at least somewhere in the jungle. They need to be try and push out the middle and bottom lanes as fast as possible, and that's why the Weaver is already heading that one up. If he could start threatening this middle tier 1 tower, the Skywrath Mage, though, is going to be slowed down, and he is still Skywrath Mage so damn fast. Not even that bit of slow. It's not a very effective slow, especially only at level 1, but that 14% slow, not enough against the natural race car abilities of the Skywrath Mage. Dire's top tower is under attack. And I have to say, I mean, I think things are going, whoa, I did not see that one coming. I was going to take a time to look at items, and I didn't actually notice that Joji was going for one hell of a build, that's for sure. A Radiance Weaver. I don't think your damage over time from Radiance is that effective against this team. You've got a lot of tanky heroes, but maybe he feels like he just had to go for something drastic. The double damage, though, coming out from Joji will work out wonders up against a solo Tidehunter that he was able to stumble into. And not enough to be able to push down this tier 1 tower, but he can rotate to the bottom tier 2 while IG are pushing down this top tier 2 tower. But I have to say, I think Lie Gaming are doing a great job just buying for time, making as many trades as possible. The fact that the net worth lead has actually dipped down here in the last, 2 minutes, I think is really to Lie Gaming's... obviously, it's to their favor, but I think it shows that they have the right mindset about this, that they're not trying to fight IG knowing that their team fight is so damn strong right now, just farming up like the enemy jungle. Anywhere they see IG, they know there's going to be 3 or 4 members there, because that's just how you run this draft from IG. They can't afford to split up too much, not up against a Weaver, Timbersaw, and Batrider, and the Skywrath Mage. You actually, all 4 of those heroes are pickoff specialists. So when you have this big team fight advantage, plus you're facing up against a lot of pickoff, you're going to be splitting up. Now they're going to make this jump. Oh, Batrider just gets blown up as he tries to jump in. Jizzbunk will take a little bit of damage here, but of course he has his ultimate to be able to fall back on. And Joji can't really do much to stop this one, as this is a team fight that Lie Gaming, I'm not sure why they thought this, but it looked like they wanted to actually take a team fight here. And I think this is really where IG have gotten to their strongest at this point in time. Lie Gaming is just trying to delay them as much as possible. I would have expected them to continue to go for this push in the bottom lane. And, like, hell, even go uphill and try and do a little bit of chip damage against the tier 3. Obviously, you're not going to take it, but just threaten IG. Force them back at some point. Even if you do give up the tier 2, that tier 2 is going to go down anyway. It's more important to make sure that you don't give up anything extra. Oh, Ravage actually going off there. Is going to be catching out XDD, and they will blow him up with an extra multicast on top. 5400 trying to back himself away from Lua. Will be able to get himself out in time. And IG now going in for the tier 3 tower. Meanwhile, the split push happening from Joji is going to be going for that tier 2 tower before he backs himself up. He will be forced to take this fight, especially with the buyback from Timbersaw displaying. Hey, we know we have to fight this. We know we can't give up this tier 3 for free. Luo actually getting another Aphotic Shield so effective up against that Telekinesis. And seeing this, seeing that just the buyback by itself is forcing IG back. Joji doing the most excellent play here. Does a decent amount of chip damage to this tier 3 tower. This is what I was talking about earlier. It's not enough to take the tower, but this kind of chip damage does build up later on into the game. So he brings it down a good 500 health. Not bad. And you compare it to the damage that IG did to this middle tier 3 tower with all 5 of their heroes pushing in. The difference is very minimal. A barrel of lust. This is a build that we've seen a number of times now, really rising in popularity. The Maelstrom going into the Mjolnir for the Viper. Once you finish up your mech and your Aghanims, oftentimes there's a question mark about where you go with your Viper from there. And it seems like that many people are settling on the early power of the Maelstrom. Joji. That multicast, so damn effective, and that's why I was thinking maybe Lincoln's would be a necessity here, as that initiating stun, despite the fact that they really don't have that many stuns, is still going to be enough to burst down the Weaver, especially if he goes for a all offense build like this with the Radiance. They do get a trade-off, though, and manage to kill the Tidehunter in the top lane. Not too bad. The tier 1 tower is going to be falling, though. As IG gets themselves even more gold. 12-5, 24 minutes in. And Vlad's Brewmaster. Well, he could go for the Aghanims build, but with the Vlad's, maybe he's opting for an Assault Cuirass and Abyssal Blade build, the kind of combat Brewmaster, the battle Brewmaster, as I've kind of dubbed it. He's going to pop his ultimate as he jumps onto Super. The ultimate for a kill on a support is also enough to probably ensure this tier 2 tower does go down. Like what XDT is doing here, though, he's trying to take out the creep wave, but unfortunately, they're already onto the tier 2 tower, so there is no backdoor protection. Once IG are forced back, though, that backdoor protection will go back up. And XTT's movement here will actually be quite effective in stalling up IG. As long as he doesn't get caught, which quick teleport away will be successful. And nice, he actually picked up a Boots of Travel, so he can continue to really threaten the split push even more as he goes from bottom lane immediately into top. Middle lane, Courier. Oh, they're making a jump onto Rubick, who's teleport away. Nicely played. And even those small things, right? Those small things like the backdooring of the creeps by the Batrider or that teleport away from the Rubick, that's like 20 seconds, 30 seconds blown, where IG then are struggling to find an objective. Do they go for the five-man push right now? Because their top lane is constantly being threatened, and it's already down to half health. They've got to send somebody back to defend this. But at the same time, when they go bottom, when they go for top, and they try and deal with these split pushes, that just gives Light Gaming a lot more time to farm up. And if the Weaver, God forbid, is able to finish up this hard, he's going to be really hard to kill. They're going to have to blow like both the Fire Blast from the Ogre Magi as well as the Ravage to be able to lock the Weaver down long enough to kill him before he time lapses. And he's also got level 3 time lapse as well, so that low cooldown. Every 40 seconds he can time lapse, plus it doesn't cost him any mana. Invisibility. Or even worse, I mean, forget about just buying themselves time. Line Gaming have actually bought themselves enough room. Look at the map control right now. Like, IG are actually kind of dealing with these split pushes so much that they are always on their side of the map, which leaves Roshan exposed. But it looks like they didn't actually have enough damage or enough tank to be able to take on Roshan. But that is something that... That is something that will come into play later on. Waiting for a pickoff somewhere here. They're not going to get the Weaver, and they're not going to get the Batrider either. And again, this top lane is still pushing in, still ripe for the split push, which XDT does have a Boots of Travel up ready to go. And IG, I'm not sure what they're going to wait on. Oh, Brewmaster actually goes for the BKB. Seeing as he's dealing with the long-duration silence of Ancient Seal, this is not a bad idea. Plus, again, there's a decent amount of magic damage, especially with the Radiance picked up by the Weaver. That adds in that just extra bit of damage over time that the BKB will be effective against. Assault Cuirass would help you break the base a little bit better, but I can see where he's going with the BKB. And now, is this the death push from IG? If they don't fully commit, though, look what XCT is doing. He's taking out this creep wave. Again, the Rat Rider strikes again as he's going to take out this middle creep wave, and IG will only have one creep wave with which to commit for this middle push. It will be enough, though. They've got plenty of tank. They've got the mech as well. They're more than willing to tank this tier 3 tower for the time being. Physical damage is a little bit slow. Oh, nice pickoff there on the courier. As that was holding on to the Refresher Orb of June. That's huge. That is a big, big play. Tier 3 tower going down. They are getting harassed bit by bit from the constant Chakram damage from XTT. And really not wanting to take this team fight. They're just trying to bring Luo down as much as possible. He is the only one in the front lines here as XDT is constantly trying to harass him, but between the Aphotic Shield plus everything else, they're gonna have to back up. Maybe they just give up this set of racks. Maybe they give up this set of racks in exchange for just time. Now Luo's actually gonna be grabbed here before the Aphotic Shield can come out, but the Ravage counter initiation is gonna be good enough, almost popping 5,400. It will be enough to kill XDT at the very least. Win them one kill and possibly this melee racks. The Weaver is going to be threatening to come in from behind, though none of the IG members are low enough for the Weaver to make a commitment. And it seems like this melee racks will be going down. And IG, do they keep on going? It looks like they feel confident enough. Despite the fact that they don't have their Refresher, they don't have Ravage anymore. They're still going to try and go for this, at least force the buybacks. One is going to come out. That's from the Rubick, though the more important one is not available. That's on the Batrider. Heart now finished up by the Weaver. Looks like they're going to be going for this one. They need to take a team fight, I think. Maybe not. Again, maybe just buying for time here. The five-man push. Looks like Light Gaming want to go for that middle tier one tower. And Weaver, hell, at this point, between the Radiance and the Heart, he's probably got enough damage and enough tank that he can backdoor that Tier 1 tower pretty quickly. So they don't necessarily have to go for a committed push here to take this tower. The Weaver can always sneak it in later on. Seems like they're still going to go for it, though. Luo trying to force him back. That's going to be a glyph burned. I'm not sure if that's a glyph that you really needed to use there. That tier 1 tower, again, due to the backdoor possibilities for the Weaver, I'm not sure if you wanted to use your glyph to defend a tier 1 tower and really just lengthen its lifespan for a minute or two longer when you may need to use that glyph for your tier 3 tower in the top lane, which has already been brought down to 500 health. That the Weaver is able to get a push into this top lane while you are distracted otherwise. He's going to be quick to take down that tower. Teleport away by 5,400. XED is going to be going for a Well, does he go for a BKB here? I think he has to. Between the Ravage plus the Ogre Magi, all that, yeah. All those two stuns combined with a decent amount of magic damage from Viper and everyone else. Seems like a BKB may be a necessity here for a Timbersaw. Not an item that he normally likes to go for, as Aghanim's or Blink Dagger, Shiva's, all those other items are a lot more fun and a lot more combative for a Timbersaw to utilize. And here it is, Joji. Sees the opportunity, will be going for the back door in that tier one tower, and will claim it too. Ravage is gonna go off here. They're gonna try and pop Joji, and with the come in from Chuan, that will be enough. The double Ravage blown. Just to be able to take out the Weaver, but he's down for a full minute, and that gives plenty of opportunities for IG to now go for a push in one of these side lanes and try and go for that second set of axe, or maybe not. They're gonna go for Roshan instead. They've got the minus armor thanks to Chisbuk and his medallion. They are going to have to send someone up to this top lane. Unfortunately, neither the Timbersaw nor the Batrider are that effective at being able to lay down physical damage, so they can push down the wave rather quickly and get the creeps onto the tower, but they themselves don't actually present that much physical damage.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
They're going to blow another glyph. The tier 1 tower going down in the middle lane will refresh it and extend this tier 3's life points a little bit longer. XTT will make a jump away, though, as knowing that the double ravages are down, no real big issue there. And, of course, the tier 3, well, they could deny it. Though oftentimes you'll see many teams leave their tier 3's up for as long as possible just because having that Rax exposed is a bit too risky. So even just sometimes 50 HP points on a tier 3 tower is enough for you to be able to leave it up, at least as a threatening marker. Power Tread's now up for the Weaver. It's the first time he's going to get upgraded boots. Unfortunately, he's not going to be making any luxury items anytime soon after that death in the middle lane. And I wonder what he goes for next. Like, does he go for more damage? Because it's obvious, like, IG, they've got so many HP points, you're having a hard time really threatening any of these heroes in team fights. Or do you go for more defense, seeing as you are being picked off by the double Ravage? Like, they're fully willing to commit everything they have just to be able to shut you down, so do you need more defense? Is the heart really not enough? Do you go for a BKB? A four-man smoke from IG while the Viper will push in. It looks like they want to go for a surprise push in the top lane. And they're going to go straight through middle too. If they find a pickoff, that's great. In fact, XDD may be in some trouble. He's going to be stunned up. Clap goes down. He's got no escape, really, as there's no trees inside the base for him to really utilize there. And they'll get that pickoff, go straight for the tier 3 tower. That kind of surprise push in is exactly what you need to do against split push. Don't abide by the rules that say you have to go in and push in this creep wave. Make that surprise push. Buy back in. Looks like the Batrider's going to be caught. He tried to force staff away. Will be able to get back to his fountain as the Ravage being used by June was not enough to kill the Batrider. Still, though, the tier 3 tower is down, but it looks like IG, they're going to be faced up. This is going to be the last team fight of the game. If IG can win it, they've got this game in the bag with two sets of racks going down. If Lie Gaming can actually win it, though, they may have a comeback on their hands. Though the melee rack's already getting low enough, and Lie Gaming still not posing much of a threat. They've got the Weaver on one side, the rest of the team on the other. Luo's going to be pulled back. I think they really need the Weaver here with the rest of the team. As you can see, IG just make a full commitment to one side or the other and just trounce the rest of Lie Gaming members. Now the Weaver comes in from behind. The rest of IG just turn around, address him, force him to pop his ultimate, and we'll go back as a team to focus on the range racks, not losing a single hero. And it seems like IG, with two sets of racks down and no really signs of stopping, should be able to claim this game, and the rather laggy delay GG will be called by Lie Gaming. So, well done by IG, very controlled. I mean, they seem to have some hard time dealing with some of the split pushes from Lie Gaming, but they were able to find enough openings. And the five-man push into the middle lane, that was enough. I mean, you're expecting them to take the first set of racks. You kind of had to give that one up to wait for the Weaver to be a lot more powerful, but that...